Hi everyone, greetings of the day. My name is Riya Bhansali and I'm a certified yoga teacher and a life coach. So today is a very special day for me because in my new segment, in the Coach Collab segment, I am introducing to you coaches and personalities that I think have made a major impact in my life, and I really wanted you to know more about them. One such person is Ms. Payal Talwar. And I'm so happy to have her on the show today and interviewing, though she's sitting in India. She's a great, great personality. So let me just introduce you to Payal. Hi Payal, how are you?
Hi Riya, very, very happy and excited to be here with you. I'm really excited to be a part of your new journey. We've shared some exciting times together and let's go for this one now.
Yeah, we've been planning for so long, and sometimes I got lazy, sometimes schedule couldn't make up. But guys, I'm telling you, if you are somebody, today's topic is something that's very close to my heart because my mom went through this, and I know so many moms go through this on a daily basis, something that's very women-centric, and I'm so happy, you know, we're going to discuss this issue, bringing in more self-awareness. Now, before we move into what the topic is exactly, let me tell you who Payal is. And her journey. She's really passionate about learning, about honoring her skills. She's certified in adult learning by the International Finance Corporation, a World Bank arm. She's a master practitioner of NLP. She's a law of attraction expert and so many more. She's helped co-found Wings Team, a dream that every day achieves its goal of helping people empower themselves. Now, if that's not enough, she's trained over 5,000 professionals globally on management, leadership, team dynamics, motivation, sales, and personal effectiveness. She's carried over more than 100 plus learning and development initiatives end to end. Now, today's topic is about, you know, how women go through and feel restless, and especially when their kids go to college or just maybe in their mid-30s. And I'm so happy that she's authored her second book, Me and My Middle Age, which is a fun and thought-provoking journey of women in her middle years of life. Now, I think this is so apt, such an apt time to, you know, have your book and discuss this topic. And overall, I can just say thank you so much, Payal, for coming here.
Thank you, Riya, for having me here.
Now, I just want to ask you, like, let's begin with, you know, what was your journey? What is life coaching? How has NLP helped in coaching? And just like an overall picture for somebody who has no idea about what life coach is or NLP is.
All right. So, Riya, life coaching is just about providing a very non-judgmental space to people so that they can, you know, just come up and be themselves. A total acceptance there. And a life coach is trained to make people look at their lives in a holistic approach, to take a different view. Once you change your view, the world changes for you. So they can look at their lives from a different viewpoint, see what is working, see what is not working, explore their beliefs. And all this is done while the life coach is almost being invisible. It's just a force holding the person. And NLP, I would say, is a toolkit, is an added toolkit, which a life coach can have. And you being an NLP master yourself, you know how much it works on the unconscious.
That's true. But you know, for me, because we've done the certification, we know this side of the world. But do you still think that this is a taboo in India? I know it's growing. I know the correct picture. But just for my audience who probably is not aware of this, what would you like to say? You know, how is the situation in India? Are people perceiving coaches well?
They more and more, I think the acceptance level is growing now. Initially, it was that why do we need a life coach when we have a family? You know, we have relatives, we have supportive friends. Why do we need a life coach? Now, more and more people are realizing that a third person doesn't have judgments, and a life coach is trained. It's not just a relative or your best friend sitting and having a chat with you. It is somebody who's trained to work on your mind, trained to make you explore your belief systems, your value systems, to really look deeper into your life. And with a relative or friend, what happens is you have a perceived judgment. One feels that I might be judged, or there might be some things you're holding back. With a life coach, it's all in the open. And the life coach, a good life coach, makes you comfortable. So I think the safe space which a life coach provides, is trained to provide, is what is causing people to be more accepting of it now. There are lots of people coming forth now.
Because I live in Bahrain, and I know it's still not very acceptable, and people still look at, you know, you as like, you know, what have you done? Is this something that, you know, everyone can just put next to their name? And just lack of awareness that, you know, there's some sort of a training related to this. So I'm glad the acceptance level is increasing. I think maybe amongst the young generation more than the older one. But yeah, in US and... Sorry?
Yes, yes, I'm with you there.
Right. Because now at least we know about it. Maybe we can Google search it and believe it with facts that, you know, this is kind of working on people. Now, coming to our topic, main focus, women for today. Often a woman might not know, you know, what she's wanting or what she's feeling restless for. I've seen that in my own mom. But, you know, you can be only a certain level of coach with your relatives. So, so that's always an obstruction. And, you know, so I know it's not only centered or specific to my mom, but so many other more women out there at different stages of life, not only maybe in the mid-30s, maybe even young women. So how can a life coach help in that area?
So I would say women definitely, after a certain period of time in their lives, you know, require some kind of a support to rediscover themselves. So typically a woman as a girl in her childhood has her dreams, has gone through an education, has gone through her qualification, she might be excelling in something, liking, having her own dreams. Once the family comes up, and typically in Asian societies, what happens is she immerses herself in bringing up the children and making a home for everybody. There she starts to lose her identity. What happens is, she's so full of doing things for others, and she gets a importance from them, from being the housekeeper, being the mother, being the caretaker. And sooner or later, once the children are grown up, she has nothing to show for herself. Her confidence in herself is totally shaken. She is not, she doesn't even know her dreams for most part. She doesn't even realize that she had dreams once. And once this emptiness syndrome sets in, that's when she starts to feel a vacuum. She feels restless, and she wants more, and she probably doesn't know how to get it. That's where a life coach can step in.
Wow, okay. So that is quite deep an issue. Because you have to kind of dig into the past and ask, like, you know, what your dreams were, and you know, if your dreams are still the same, and you know, how you can go forward with. So how can a woman in her late 30s, I'm just assuming because that's the time where most of the women start feeling that, or, you know, choose to ignore, start her own career or build something from scratch, or just find the resources within herself to feel more valuable or confident for that matter?
You've just hit the nail on the head. So feel more confident is the major part. A woman is a superwoman. Every woman is a superwoman, I would say. It's just that they need to feel that superpower. Because they've done so much, but all they have to show for themselves are probably grown-up children. And those grown-up children, you know, they don't have any experience on a CV that they can show for a job. So there, what they need to be assisted in is looking into what used to be important and what still is important and what fulfills them. You're right, dreams change. Maybe what she wanted back in her 20s is not what she wants now. As long as she can identify her values and get to what she wants to do now, she can then be helped to carve out a path. It's one is awareness. Second is identification.
Yeah.
And third is going the path, walking the path, doing something about it. And often this is the area which requires a lot of support, because the confidence is shaky. You don't know whether your skills are redundant, they're still, you know, in demand in the market, what you were once, or would you like to start something else? Maybe the family is supporting, maybe it is saying ki theek hai kar liya, now relax at home.
Yeah, that's so, a common thing that we hear, like, you know, your husband is always already earning, why do you want to do it? Because it's considered as a means to something rather than, you know, like an end goal probably. This is something like, why do you want to work? Please relax.
You worked all your life, you brought up the children, now you please relax. And that's when the woman wants to carve out an identity. She says, nahi yaar, abhi tak to I was working for you. Now I want a name for myself. Yes. And it could be as basic as learning to make beautiful cuisines at home. Even if that fulfills her, it doesn't have to be a career. Whatever gives her fulfillment is what she has to look for. So life coaching assists in that, in helping her discover, rediscover, rekindle the flame.
Right. So I'm curious to know, like, when did you observe that this was a common problem amongst women? Of course, I know you've done these several workshops and now you have these NLP certifications and you've trained so many people. But when did you realize that, oh, I'm getting this problem, you know, again and again amongst women, or I notice it, or they're not addressing?
So, Riya, happened to me, firstly.
Wow.
Oh. So I have two beautiful children.
So, once they were well on their feet, you know, they typically in middle school, they start being independent. They're not that dependent on you anymore. The husband is well on his way in his career. The life is good. We would say that often there's nothing lacking on the outside. People probably would look at you and envy you. But inside you start to feel that there has to be more purpose to me. There has to be more meaning to my life. So that is when I started, you know, dabbling with NLP, started certifying myself. My partner and I, Priyanka, we came together to form this company, which was WINGS, used to be the acronym for Women in Need for Grander Success. So we found our friends all around us going through the same thing. So we said, how can we provide a platform for all women so that they could, wherever they are. So we started with that idea, and more I realized, as soon as I met these women, talked to them, there's some very, very strong women, very skilled, talented, disciplined women who can do so much, want to do so much. And that doesn't mean they ruffle the house. The house and them can go well together. They just need somebody to believe in them. And a life coach believes in them more than they believe in themselves. So that's where it all started, and I thought that this was a segment I wanted to work with.
Wow, I know my mom went through the same thing, and you know, as to the audience, just in general, like when Payal brought out the topic that, you know, she wants to discuss this, I was like, wow, mom went through this, and you know, we couldn't do anything about it because we were away for college. I'm the younger one, so as soon as I left, my tuitions were over, her life around my routine was over. And then she's like, okay, now what next? Like, what do we do? And then she discovered, like, you know, joining the Indian Ladies Association here and, like, giving back. And that's when her identity built. So it's actually great that women don't take their children as somebody holding back their identity or holding a grudge against anyone. And I find that, like, you know...
Absolutely.
Yeah, there's no grudge attached. That's such a superpower, I think.
I really believe that. I think women are made up of so much. If they're just willing to take that step, there's so much that they can achieve. I am passionate about this field.
I can truly see that. And WINGS, can you tell me a little more about that? Because I also knew a particular segment about it when we spoke last. But just a detail about, you know, I just want my audience to know what this interesting organization is about.
Okay, so what happened was, both of us are from the army background, And in the army, typically we are in the back of beyond areas where women really can't have much of a career. So we saw this frustration building up a lot because they are qualified, they are and they're doing a lot of work for the army. For the lot of social work goes in, but they are not finding their own fulfillment, what they are trained for. So we started this, and now we have three arms. We have a content writing arm.
Wow.
We have a training and facilitation arm, and we have a life coaching arm. So this content writing deals with academic and social media content, anything with the written word. And very happy to say there are about 200 women associated with us now, off and on different projects.
Wow.
So they find their fulfillment wherever they might be. And you know what, Riya, the thing I've realized is a woman just needs to be herself, find that she's worth earning. For her, at that stage in life, the amount of money doesn't matter. It is that she belongs to an organization. She has an identity within itself, and people consider her worth something. So it's so beautiful to see all of them doing such great work. And then, of course, they're the trainers and facilitators. And now we have men also with us. So we get inspired by grand success. So it's no longer only women centric.
I'm glad I didn't know about the three wings of three arms of wings, but it's amazing. And I'm sure, like, because of so many women being associated, I have a question. Like, so did you see this pattern in women? I know you also work with international clients who are not Indians. So have you seen this pattern in women in general, like only in India or like across the globe?
I would say it is there across the globe. I have some clients who are American women, working very high professionals, leadership roles. But again, that guilt of having a home, having children, leaving them, coming for work, it is the same. Juggling two roles, it is the same. So they also give up their work to be able to be full-time mothers, and getting back on their feet is more difficult. So I don't think it is related to India or Asian women only. It is a syndrome which is across the globe, because a woman takes it upon herself that she is the first one who has to be responsible for the house. And this is, mind you, this is the responsibility we get into ourselves. Nobody gives it to us. The man also might think that he's equally responsible, but we like to take the role. So naturally then.
But I also thought this was something that our society has taught ever since we were kids. And so, you know, like women are told much more that, you know, they're responsible, or we've seen our moms take the responsibility more, or we've seen the grandparents giving the responsibility to the female of the household more. So is that also related to somewhat the culture? Can you?
That would be cultural. That is in India, more or less. It's more Indian. And I think somewhere, Riya, this is changing. With your generation, for example, you would hold the guy also equally responsible for the house. But having said that, a female is the one who births the child. So that period at least has to be taken out. But now more and more the guys are pitching in. And it is just, I think, a mindset shift which has to happen, which is happening, which is a good thing. You have women in the forces now, soldiering along. I mean, there's nothing to stop them. They're as tough as the male counterparts. So, so I don't think, I think it's a cultural thing more in India. Mm-hmm. And of course, we women have to make a shift for ourselves. Can't hold anybody responsible.
That's absolutely right. Having said that, I've also noticed some women don't even realize that, you know, this sort of a thing is happening. Or I would just say, how do a person or a woman or maybe somebody else, the family of the woman, identify for herself, or that, you know, this is happening, or how can some self-awareness be thrown light on? How do they know that these are, oh, this is happening, and, you know, so this is probably the problem that I could be facing. So what would you say to a woman like that?
Very, very good question, Ria, because you're right. They just get immersed in it and one doesn't realize it. I would say the family can find out easily, and if the woman is not finding out herself, if her being is attached to what is happening in the house, she's totally involved with, you know, okay, the cooking didn't turn out right, and she beats herself totally about it. The child is going to a college, and instead of being a support, she is actually the one who's doing all the work. If her whole being is just about the house, if somebody observes that about a lady at home, a woman at home, or the mother at home, that's a warning signal. That means she's lost all the interest that she had. If she doesn't take out the time for herself to read, write, embroider, meditate, exercise, anything. If there's no time that the woman is taking out for herself, and her importance gets linked to how good the home or children are.
Yes.
That's definitely a sign where one has to look into it. Because more or less, she would be leading her children's life. And there, then going off is going to cause a distress somewhere.
Wow, that's a really nice sign. I think even the family should be helping at this point of time, bringing awareness. I'm sure if we had, as kids, knew that, you know, our mom could go through something like that. Although I think this is not very severe, and women come out of it really fast, but just the fact that you have to go through it itself is upsetting. Yeah. Why should they? I mean, they have a idea.
Yeah, and why should they? And in the whole process, what happens, Ria, they forget themselves. They forget their dreams.
Yes.
So to rediscover themselves becomes, they feel lonely.
Exactly.
Once the children are gone, because the husband is in his career path. He might be the best person on earth, but he is on his own. So, loneliness sets in. With loneliness comes a lot of depression, negativism, self-image issues. They start beating themselves about the way they look. You know, whole lot of other things creep in.
Right. So, it's added. It's just added in
bulk. Yeah. Absolutely.
Alright, so Payal, tell me, like, during this phase, or maybe before or after, how can the family be a support, real support during this time?
So, Ria, the first thing is the family has to listen to her dreams. Make her talk more about herself. In every conversation, maybe they could just make her approach her dreams, what she was interested in, talk about her childhood, and not treat her just as the role that she's playing. Once she becomes real for them, once she gets in touch with what she was as a girl in college, as a young person, as a professional, her dreams will start coming back. And maybe they could help her on a journey of finding herself and going forward. Support if she wants to open a business, she wants to go back to a career, whatever she wants to do. So the family just has to be there for her, as she's been there for so many years.
Right. So I just, like, something just popped in my head, and I've seen, like, really ambitious and really successful women when they enter motherhood, or, like, the role change. It could even be marriage and not necessarily motherhood. How does, because it's such a long period of time, maybe like 15 to 20 years, this 15 to 20 years completely overshadows the kind of achievements they've achieved in probably the first 20 years of this life. So can you just throw a light upon, you know, why this is more impactful, and why does this take over that phase, and just in general?
So this is also to do with age, Riya, I would say. The first 20 years of your career are something, you know, you're giving full of yourself. You're giving all of yourself to your career. There are no holds barred. You're ambitious. You're looking at a certain level to reach. And when you come out of it and you focus on bringing up a family, it's a different kind of focus. You are getting fulfilled. You are doing your bit. So it is not as if you're not happy or you're not fulfilled. Even that part is very fulfilling. It is only once this is slightly taken care of, the children are older, and you know, the husband is more settled in his career, that's when you start missing that what I had. Maybe had I continued, I would have reached a certain... And you see your contemporaries who've not left their jobs, who've not left their careers, reach a certain level, and you're still here trying to discover what you want. So that's the impact it can have, that you start looking at them and feeling smaller. So that I don't think a woman should need to feel. So she should be able to pick up her bits, and whatever she is at, there's always something that can be done. There's always something. May not be the same career, maybe something else.
Right.
There's always ways and options and means. You just have to discover them.
That's true. So what are the few things that can be done by young women who might enter this stage, or just to avoid dependency? What would you say to them?
So I would say nowadays young women don't need to really leave their careers. They can manage both very easily. They get maternity leaves, and there's just a period of 9 months of total period. They just need those last 2-3 months, and in some cases not even that, and some time afterwards. They have supportive parents and in-laws who can pitch in. Here's where the family can pitch in, so that they don't have to really give up the career. If they're looking at getting to a certain level in the same career, then they really cannot take 15 years off. So I feel the young women have to decide for themselves. And therein comes the strength from within, the belief of convictions, the superwoman part of a woman, that she can handle it all. And she doesn't need to really create disturbances. You know, she a woman that way is blessed, that with her smile and with her way of being, gently, she can float through it. And in this, again, I would say, having a life coach at that stage, somebody who believes in you, somebody who keeps reminding you that, okay, don't worry, this can be handled, we can do it together, I believe in you. Somebody who is there for her, apart from the family, with a very detailed, and can help her with her mind, help her look into options, could really help her.
And then, navigate her, because she has to do that herself anyway.
Kind of navigate her.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
But Payal, I want to ask you, like, these are of course the issues that we're talking about, is, you know, all these self issues that you have, that your mind doesn't allow you and all of that. But what are some of the real issues that this is all an internal fight which is happening, and we have to kind of overcome it, and self-image and identity. But what are some of the real issues that women are facing, and how do they overcome that? Like, it could be pressure from the family or the in-laws or their own family or the husband or so many more that I can't even probably name. How would you try to give a guidance to someone in that situation?
So, yes, Riya, see, there are some very, very real issues of, let's say, marital disharmony. There is mental harassment. A woman wants to do something and the in-laws feel that, you know, the bahu of our family will not work, will not go out.
Yes.
You know, it's like you have money, you have everything. Why do you want to go out and work for somebody? So, there are these real issues. Now, in that, I would say the woman has to find out what is important for her. How much is her breaking point? You know, that tipping point, that I'm not going to take this much.
Yes.
Itna ho gaya, isse upar nahi. And she has to have that steel within herself. She has to be willing to take that. Another thing I would really tell all the women out there is that do not take abuse. Mental, physical. If something is making you uncomfortable, is making you unhappy, it's time for a change. It's time to look at it, because a woman, her daughter is going to be what she is. So she is not impacting just herself. Her daughter is going to look at her and imbibe the same values. If she is giving in, I have had coaches, Rhea, who are not physically harmed, but there's a lot of mental abuse. And very good families, not that they are from any disturbed families or something, just while speaking, it is like she would be serving everybody, and then if something is not right, it is her responsibility. And then baat karte karte, it goes on to her family, her upbringing. So these kind of things, yes. So my request to all the women would be, please do not take it, because your children are looking at you. And they will imbibe the same values. Firstly, it's just not fair to bring up a girl with the same values that she is tomorrow undergoing the same treatment. So a woman has to be strong. And if the in-laws can't change the bahu, they also know she's the only one. So you can take a few risks. There is no harm. They're not going to replace you.
Yeah, that's true, because I've seen some of it happening in our community in itself. And I think that's just treated as the way it will go forward, rather than someone standing up for themselves. And I think I would say maybe somewhere even I'm at fault, because we're not fighting for them. But there's only so much of battle that, you know, an external person can do if the internal fight is not going on. Because you end up being the bad person, and the person who's going through it is completely okay with it somehow. So I've observed instances, and I'm like, how are you taking this episode that's going around so casually? And they don't seem to be having a problem with it, which is what amuses me, actually.
That is true. You know, Rhea, there is a thing about being the victim also. Some women resign to it, and they make their peace with it. So I guess unless they want to change, they want to have, nothing changes if nothing changes. So unless they want the change and they move towards it, one really can't do much. If they're okay with that, if they resign to their fate, and some enjoy being the victims also.
That's a good story, actually, that you can tell to yourself and the other person, and then gain sympathy from your... Yes, that's a common type, actually, yes.
Yeah, it's all about the stories we tell ourselves.
That is true, but this is such a great conversation. I'm sure we can't go too deep into it because of the time, and, you know, whatever, like, an extract to you from you, had this been a personal interview, it would have been different. But I want to know, what are the top three advices that you want to give to women that are listening to you probably today?
Right, top three. First would definitely be value yourselves. Unless you value yourself, nobody else is going to do that. Don't lose yourselves. It's just not worth anything in the world. Second is, find what makes you happy. You don't have to be defined by the society. You could be happy running a house, or you could be happy running a company. Find your happiness. And I would say third would be, keep in mind that your children are watching you. For me, that's a very, very important point that I tell all women. Your daughters are going to be like you. They are looking at you.
Yes.
If you want a different life for them, make a different life for yourself.
Yeah, because they rightly say that your kids actually follow your example rather than your advice. And the subconscious is registering everything.
Yes.
that is it. I would say just keep that in mind.
I think for me, the third one would be the first one. I think because you're being an inspiration for someone, and one life, at least one life, is being influenced by you. And that I've heard in a couple of celebrities also. They're like, no, my daughter shouldn't do this, so I shouldn't do this. And that's a really powerful thing for anyone who's actually listening to this. It was a great conversation. I hope you actually realize that coaching can help you remove the taboo of finding help from somebody who doesn't know you. In fact, I think I would take this as a positive sign. If I don't know a life coach, I think that's better, because you know, you're not connected in my social circle and the secrets will not kind of be revealed anywhere. So I actually work the other way around, and anyone who's fearing somebody external judging you, please make sure the ones who are close to you are already judging you based on that. And maybe this life coach can actually take you out of this problem without any judgment. So the taboo, let's cut that out today. And it's great. But I also want to ask you, Payal, like, Wings is doing such a great job at this. So anyone who wants to kind of reach out to you, or maybe for themselves, or maybe for their family members, how can Wings kind of combat this problem?
Yes, Ria. So we have our social media presence, and I can share my number in email with you. So on the social media, on FB and Instagram and Twitter and LinkedIn, you will find us as Wings Team. So there will be a lot of other Wings teams also, but we have a W as a logo.
Right. We will make sure we write this below, and you know, there's a photo of this. Wings, so that any of you who are interested can actually get in touch. And I know for a fact, Payal is not saying this out loud, but there are amazing programs that they do. They're doing the NLP certifications also now. Am I right? Despite the lockdown, so that's a great initiative. They're certifying people online, and I would have loved to be the first person to do that, but I've already done my certification. That's why this interview is actually happening, because we know each other. But can you tell me a little about the program, and you know, if I'm somebody who doesn't know about NLP at all, why should somebody join these programs in general?
So NLP practitioner certification program, firstly, is a life transformation program. So NLP is, I like to call it, a user manual for the mind. So it's neuro-linguistic programming. Neuro is your thinking, linguistic is the language, and programming is how you respond or behave. So if you can tweak this, your thinking or your language, you can tweak this. And NLP teaches you a lot of processes on which you can actually practically do on yourself, and your life gets sorted. The creases come out. So apart from getting a global certification, which is from the National Federation of NLP, this program will actually cause a transformation. Because before working with others, you will be working with yourself. And you will be exploring all that. Yes. So I think that's a very, one program that I love is this, because along with changing your life, you get a global certification. And you can work with others after.
Wow, this sounds amazing, at least to me, because I know this process and I know how empowering it can be. That's what actually helped me clear my CA final examination. For those of you who don't know, I'm a chartered accountant as well. This was a tipping point, you know, where it broke kind of my self-beliefs. And CA is such a small part of my life. So for any women who are facing any of these issues, or any issues, even the ones which we've actually not discussed, I would love to introduce you to Payal and her team. They're amazing at what they're doing, influencing more than 200 people today with such a great organization, and now online. So wherever you are, you can actually get in touch with all the links that we have displayed below, Instagram, Facebook. And I'm sure they're going to be so receptive, and they're going to be ready to help you, because that's what we all are here for today. For women today, empowering them. With this, thank you so much, Payal, for this amazing time and this amazing interview. It actually opened up a lot of things in me also, because I've not faced these marital issues yet, because I'm not married. But it kind of is so helpful, because you know, I know what to keep in mind. I know what to keep in mind, and probably actually advise other women who are maybe going through this or this phase, you know, I can, there's some sort of a direction to them. So any last words you would like to tell my audience?
Just stay happy and feel fulfilled. Have a purpose in life. That's all that is needed. Thank you so much, Riya. As always, wonderful talking to you, having this heart-to-heart, mind-to-mind kind of an interaction. As always, really feeling nice about it.
I hope this serves the purpose of actually educating the public in large. Thank you, women, for joining us. Get in touch with me or Payal. I can directly get you in touch with her. Do follow us on YouTube, on Instagram. My handle is Riya Bhansali and Riyog. And you can call me on the number below. That's my WhatsApp number. Would love your feedback. If you want any more interviews with Payal that you want to address, so do write to me and we can arrange probably another interview with her. All right, thank you. Signing off. Bye-bye, Payal. Thank you, viewers. Namaste, everyone. Namaste. Thank you.